I call on the representative of Pakistan.
Thank you so much, Mr. President. My delegation is obliged to take the floor in exercise of our right to reply in response to the statement made by the representative of India yesterday. True to their ideological progenitors, the RSS, the Indian statement betrayed a sense of conceited self-righteousness, symptomatic of the malady that has become the feature of the communal-driven face of India. Mr. President, for an ideology seeped in hatred, the very mention of hate speech was outrageous, a crass attempt at self-glorification by those whose singular accomplishment has been to denude India of any pretense to its so-called secular credentials. As far as sketchy understanding of history, may I remind the Indian representative of what a certain M.S. Goldwalkar, one of the founding fathers of the RSS, the ideological fountainhead of the BJP, who has been hailed by Prime Minister Modi as revered Guruji, had to say about the place of non-Hindus in India. He said, and I quote, "Non-Hindus must either adopt the Hindu culture and language and learn to respect and revere Hindu religion, or they may stay in the country wholly subordinated to the Hindu nation, claiming nothing, deserving no privileges." I unquote. Today, Mr. President, this ideal of Hindu supremacy is being put into place with a single-minded zealousness in India. With every act of the repugnant assault of cow vigilantes, with every gruesome mob lynching, with every forced reconversion, the supremacist RSS ideology is on display ever more brazenly. Far from being a so-called vibrant democracy, this is becoming a living hell for those perceived and treated as the other in the saffron India. Tellingly, those who assassinated Mahatma Gandhi in 1948 are now busy killing the idea of a secular India espoused by him. Mr. President, it is obvious that India neither wants to face up to the truth about its abominable policies and actions, nor does it want others to see it. When my Prime Minister spoke here yesterday, he put a spotlight on what Indian government has been desperately trying to hide from the world, both in terms of its indefensible actions against the people of Kashmir, but also its egregious treatment of minorities across the length and breadth of India. But what we heard in response, Mr. President, was obfuscation, deception, and an attempt to divert attention from the ugly ground realities. We are not surprised. This is the most familiar trick in the Indian playbook, and it was in full play last evening. It is strange that a country that has been engaged in the state's terrorism in occupied Jammu and Kashmir for over 30 years has the temerity to accuse others of terrorism. In fact, may I remind the Indian delegation of the position of 120 members of the non-aligned movement that repression of people under occupation amounted to the gravest form of terrorism and should be denounced as such. It is also rather rich, Mr. President, that a country whose serving naval officer, Commander Kulbhushan Jadhav, was caught red-handed for espionage, sabotage, and terrorism has the gumption to term the victim as the perpetrator. A country which is in the iron grip of the fascist RSS, which was thrice banned in India for terror-related charges, has the audacity to point fingers towards others. If at all, India should seek answers from the perpetrators of the Samjhota terrorist attack, who were acquitted earlier this year. India should seek answers from the killers of Pehlu Khan, who was killed in cold blood for transporting cattle by a violent cow vigilante mob in 2017. India should seek answers from the masterminds of Gujarat pogrom in 2002, whose political fortunes have bloomed while the innocent victims flinch in pain and misery. The common threat, Mr. President, behind these and countless other incidents is that victim has had the misfortune of finding himself against the might of the all-encompassing Hindutva onslaught. Mr. President, yesterday, Amid the Indian PN to its millennia-old heritage of diversity, pluralism, and tolerance, if there was one virtue that failed to find a cursory mention, it was the plight of the people of occupied Jammu and Kashmir. The Indian representative deliberately did not mention the complete and cruel lockdown, including a communications blackout in occupied territory. Neither did she mention the plight of the innocent Kashmiris, who for the last 53 days have been forced to live without food and essential supplies. 53 days without information of the well-being of family and friends. 53 days of total darkness and an abiding fear of the unknown with no end in sight. We were instead treated to a fable that illegal Indian annexation of the occupied territory was meant to remove hindrances to the development of the occupied territory. No doubt, a novel model of development where the relevant stakeholders are not mainstreams, but instead locked up, their voices muffled, and their liberties taken away. If indeed the actions undertaken are so well-meaning to the people of Jammu and Kashmir, I asked the Indian representative, why does the Indian state not allow the Kashmiri people to come out and express their feeling? Why is India so afraid? While Pakistan has nothing to hide, does India have the moral courage to respond to the findings of the United Nations Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights reports on occupied Jammu and Kashmir that have documented litany of barbaric Indian repression in the occupied territory? If not, the creaking Indian defense is nothing but a self-perpetuating farce. The central reality of all this, Mr. President, is the dire human rights and humanitarian situation in occupied Jammu and Kashmir, and the denial of fundamental right of self-determination pledged to Kashmiris by India, Pakistan, and the international community as enshrined in the 11 UN Security Council resolutions. I thank you.